Hi everybody, welcome back to the BBC Learning English Live Friday Quiz. Good to see you all again. Now my name is Dylan and I will be your host for the day. In today's episode of the Live English Quiz, we're looking at the language of spoken English. So vocabulary and slang and contractions, and we're going to hear from a very special guest who's going to teach us a little bit about how to improve our pronunciation. So say hello, tell me, what is your name? Where are you from? Okay, so let's have a big hello to everybody who is here today. So Devandra saying, hi, it's 24 degrees Celsius in my city. And I was, I'm here in London, and I think it's about 20 degrees today. We got Nora. Hi again, Nora. Good to see you. Christina, hi. We got Zainab. Hi. Hi, Dylan. How are you? Hi from Kyrgyzstan. A big hello from London. I'm very good, as always. You catch me on a good mood because it is Friday and it is nearly the weekend. We've got hello from Egypt. Hi, Shazli. Osman, hello. Sadeg. We've got Haiti from Peru. Hello, says Darwan. And from Dhaka, Mamadou. Hi there. All right then, everybody. So how are you today? Let's quickly go over the rules. You've seen them a million times, but if you are new, there are 8 questions. We do the questions first. We look at the answers later on. It is just for fun. There are no prizes. We're here to educate ourselves, to have a bit of entertainment, and to have a good time on a Friday. It is social media. Of course, it will help us. If you like, if you're enjoying yourself, if this is useful, hit that like button now. Please comment, because being active in your learning really will help. And of course, share with your friends, family members, students, teachers. The more, the merrier. Let's see who we've got. Ileana, sounds like a teacher. The prize is learning, as you always say. Exactly that. The prize is to learn something new. We've got a hello from Bangladesh and from Pakistan. Hiya. We've got hello from Japan and from Tenerife. What's the weather like in the UK today? It's hot, but a bit overcast. So it's not too sunny, but it's a little bit hot. So a little bit humid today. Cameron says it's very good weather over here in Bangladesh. Great to hear it. I hope you've all got great weather for the weekend. And we got a few more hellos. Hi, and hi, Leonardo. And from Bessem, hello from Tunisia. Okay then, everybody. Oh, before we start, I got something to tell you, okay? We're very excited to say that in July, me and Rob are going to try a new format with the quiz. So variety is the spice of life. So in July, we're going to change a new little format, new types of questions, new ideas. It's going to be a brand spanking new, updated and improved live English quiz. So stay tuned. We'll have more information in the coming weeks. Okay, let's get started with this quiz. Round one. Here we go. Are you ready? So here, I'm not going to read out the answers because it'd be too much of a clue. So you're going to read the answers. In which of these sentences is the word red? In which of these sentences is the word read pronounced differently? Okay, we've got A, B, C, and D. In 3 of them, they're pronounced the same. In 1 of them, they're pronounced differently. Which one is the odd one out? Which one is read pronounced in a slightly different way? So take a look. Okay. Let me know what you think. Okay, so I can see lots of answers coming in already. But which one? And if you know the answer, tell me why. Why do you think that answer is the odd one out? Why is it different? Okay, so Johnicky is saying C. And I won't read out the answer because it'll be too much of a clue. Yilin, oops, is said C for sure because it's the past participle. Do you agree with that? Or do you disagree? What do you think? Keep your answers coming in. Andrea says it is in the past. Okay. And Kim says, of course, present perfect. Well, do you agree with Kim and Andrea, or have you got a different opinion? Get your answers coming in. Round two, let's move on. Okay, remember, we'll do the questions first, and we look at the answers later on. So, round two of the quiz. Aha. Which of these is not correct? I listened to an interesting last night. I listened to an interesting talk. I listened to an interesting speak. I listened to an interesting speech. So A, B, C, talk, speak, or speech. Which one of these is not correct? Get your answers in. So I can see a few answers coming in. We've got a few B's coming in and a few C's. So a little bit of variety here, B's and C's. Lay's going for A, talk. So we're looking for a noun in this. And which of these is not a noun or can't be a noun? Let me know in the comments. Okay, B, C, C. So B's and C's coming in. Round three. Aha. So we're looking at phrasal verbs, which of course are very important and often quite tricky. So so which of these means to talk louder? Speak, we can't hear you at the back. Speak, we can't hear you at the back. What? Is it A, speak up? Is it B, speak out? Is it C, speak volumes? Or is it D, speak your mind? Which of these do you think it is? Let us know. Get your answers coming in. Huda is saying, speak up. We got Fataha saying, up. Huda, up. Alisa, up. Lots of you saying, speak up. But we've got a few speak out as well. We got A's and B's are the common answers. Ileana is saying definitely A, while Fuji is saying maybe A or B. So A or B, is it speak up? Is it speak out? Or do you think it is C or D? Whew. Round four, here we go. Round four, question tags. Now, question tags are so important in English. When we speak, we use them all the time, but they can be a bit tricky. Let's take a look. Which of these question tags works best? The test wasn't so bad. The test wasn't so bad, were it? The test wasn't so bad, was it? The test wasn't so bad, wasn't it? Or the test wasn't so bad, didn't it? A, B, C, or D? Were it, was it, wasn't it, didn't it? Nazarene has come in with D, didn't it? Abdelakta is going for A, were it. And we got Kamru Zaman agreeing. Ahmed, Yilin, Rosella, all going for B. So a nice bit of variety. Lots of B's coming in, but I can see lots of C's as well. Remember, we look at the questions now. Later on, we look at the answers, and I'll explain a bit more about why we chose that correct answer. Okay, then. Let's move on. You've got three more seconds. Get your answers in. Three, two, one. On we go to round five, which is my favorite round, as I say every week, because this is when we get our special guest. So please welcome back to the show, Jiaying.
Hello, everyone. Hi, Dylan. How are you?
I'm fantastic. I'm down in London. The weather's pretty good and it's Friday, so I'm in a very good mood. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you. I'm also in London. It's really hot today, but, you know, it's summer.
Yeah, yeah. And do you enjoy the hot weather? Have you enjoyed the mini heat wave we've had this week?
Well, I like it when it's sunny outside. But I don't really do well in the sun, so I prefer hiding in my room next to a fan and just chilling, read a book or something.
Yeah, you've got to keep yourself cool during this mini heat wave we've got.
Yeah.
So, Jiaying, for anybody who does not know you, could you give yourself a brief introduction, please?
Of course. I am a producer at BBC Learning English. Some of you might be familiar with my voice because I was one of the presenters on The English We Speak.
Okay, and Jiaying, I've got to say, your pronunciation is fantastic. And
That's very nice of you to say.
And I'm sure that most of the audience will think that you're a native speaker. But when did you start learning English?
Well, like many of you here, English is not my first language. So I started learning English when I was in primary school.
So quite a long time, there we say. And what have you, because today we're speaking about speaking and spoken English, what pronunciation tips do you have for someone who wants to improve their pronunciation?
So when I was doing listening exercises, I would often record myself and listen to it. Sometimes when you're listening to yourself, it's easier to pick up the things or mistakes you don't normally notice. So I find it very helpful.
So even though it can be a little bit awkward and embarrassing sometimes, it's good to record yourself and listen back. And what do you think is the benefit of listening to your own voice back?
Because when you're just repeating what someone else has said in, say, like a recording, it's easy to just miss the things that sound odd. But when you're listening to yourself, it's easier for you to discover what you might already know. Oh, this should be pronounced this way, but you don't hear it when you're just speaking it. But when you're listening back to yourself, you can always pick it up and then improve it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that when you listen to yourself, even though the first few times it's a bit awkward, it gets easier with time, doesn't it?
Yeah, I've been there.
Okay, so I believe you've got a question for us today, a pronunciation question.
I do. So there are four words on the screen, as you can see. And which one of these four words doesn't rhyme with the rest? So which one is the odd one out?
So we're looking for the one that does not rhyme or sound the same as the others, correct?
Correct.
And it's quite tough, isn't it? The O-U-G-H words.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it might be a tricky question. Let's see what the audience are saying. We've got some D's, some B's coming in. So a nice bit of variety. So nice question, Jiaying. And I believe you're going to come back later on to give the answer and to give us some more pronunciation tips.
Yes. Good luck, everyone. I'll see you later.
Thank you. See you soon. Bye. Okay. So that was a question from Jiaying. It's a bit of a tough one. We've got lots of people going for D, D, and lots of you going for B. So B and D. Okay, the words beginning with C seem to be the ones that people think are slightly different. So a few more seconds, get your answer in. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and on we go to round 6. Okay. Oh, let me remove question number 5. Okay, so here we're looking at slang, and this is British slang. Okay, so these would be very common in the UK, but you probably wouldn't hear them used like this in other countries so much. Mika was well, that his team had won. Mika was well gutted. Mika was well chuffed. Or Mika was well knackered. So we're looking for the word that means happy, celebrating, in a good mood. Mika was well A, gutted, B, chuffed, or C, knackered. And we've got A's coming in. We have got B from Evgeny. We have got C coming in. We've got Catherine is very confident with the C, knackered. We got B coming in. So nice variety of questions. So Tangina's going for chuffed. Maria, your comment has gone, Maria. Excuse me, it's too many flying in. You're liking this question. Loads of comments, because learning slang is so important for everyday speech. A lot of us learn English from a book, a textbook, or from our teachers, and we sometimes miss out on these important words that we use in everyday English. All right then, a few more seconds. 3, 2, 1. On we go to round 7. Aha. And last week we tried something different where we put the words in the correct order. For question 7, we're going to try something different again. We're going to put these words in the order of volume. Can you put the quietest one first and the loudest one at the end? So quiet first and loud at the end. So in order of volume going up, which is the quietest first and then loudest later on? What do you think? Let's take a look. So I'm going to give you a minute or so to get your answers coming in. It's a bit of a tricky one, this, I think. So you're going to put which one is quiet, and you want to put 4 words, quietest first, then to the loudest. So Latanya, okay, the answers are coming in. We've got, where's Latanya gone? Latanya says, whisper, bellow, declare, call out. Do you agree? Manuel has got exactly the same, but do you agree with Manuel and Latanya, or do you agree with Evgeny, who says whisper, declare, call out, bellow? What do you think? Okay, so looking for the correct order. Boom. Whisper, bellow, declare, call out. So you got the idea, but what do you think? I know many of you are picking whisper first, but there's quite a lot of variety amongst the next 3. Because when we talk about words for speaking or making a noise, we've got lots and lots of words, a wide vocabulary, so it can be difficult to learn them all. I will explain them all later on, so don't go anywhere. All right, a few more seconds to get your answers in. While you do that, while we're waiting, if you're enjoying, hit that like button. If you're on YouTube, hit that subscribe button so you never miss any of our videos. Okay, you can find us on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube. You can find us at bbclearningenglish.com. There's loads and loads of content for us. Subscribe, stay tuned. Okay, 3 seconds, and on we go. Round eight, ha, ha, ha. Contractions. So contractions are when we take one word or more than one word and we shorten it down so that it's easier when we are speaking or when we are especially texting. So contractions tend to be quite informal. Nowadays, because we spend so much time on social media or on texting each other, these are increasingly common. But which of these is not a contraction? A, dunno. B, y'all. C, dya. D, gotta. E, pitta. Or F, lemme. And Hafsa says, interesting question. Good. I can see a nice variety of answers coming in. We've got Sep24 saying E, pitta. Okay. We've got anybody else coming in. We've got Stefan going for C. We've got Krishna going for A, and Elisa's going for B. So Switi is going for D, and lots of E's coming in. But a nice variety. So do you agree with the crowd that it's C, or have you got a different opinion? So which of these is not a contraction we use in spoken English? Whew, okay. That is the halfway mark. We have looked at the questions. We're now going to do the important part, which of course is the answers. So if you are ready, let's begin. Round one. So in round one, we looked at in which sentence is the word read pronounced differently? A, B, C, or D? And I know many of you went for the same answer. And lots of you, I think it was Yilin, who said it's because it's one of them is the past participle. It is. Which sentence has the past participle in it? So let me read them out, okay? I can't read the text, it's too small. He can read my mind. She has read many books this year, and her new book is a must read. The correct answer is, of course, C. She has read many books this year. Now, did you get that one correct? I saw lots of C's coming in. As many of you told me, this is because it's in the past tense. In both the past simple and the past participle, read is pronounced red, same as the color, same pronunciation as the color. So I read a good book yesterday, or I have read many good books recently. Must read implies the present or the future, because you recommend that somebody must read it. Okay, a must read book is a book that is very good. It's so good that everybody should read it. It's a must read. We can use it with books or research papers or articles or magazine articles as well. You highly recommend it. It's a must read. Now, a little note, there is an adjective which uses the past pronunciation, which is well read. And we use that to describe somebody who is very knowledgeable, very smart, and they have read a book, read a lot of books. We call them well read. Now, can you use read or read to tell me about your favorite books of the year, or the books you recommend, or the books you want to read? Get your answers coming in. Okay, we got one out of one. Salika, well done. Evgeny got it right. Let's have a look. Huda Huda, one out of one. Okay. So let's take a look at this one from Remo. I can read my first book on 17th of July, 2022. Okay, so I can, so July is in the future, so I will be able to. Remo, good job. Monica, 101, very good. Any questions? Okay, so Faridun, give the example sentence. I've recently read a book by the name Skyth. Very good. Okay, nice example sentence. Let's have a look. Any more questions? Has must read the same meaning as bestseller? So bestseller is when a lot of these books have been sold in the country. Okay, so that means in the UK, the bestseller are the books that most people have bought or downloaded. Must read can be a personal recommendation. So maybe I read a new book, and I go, wow, I give it to my best friend, say, this is a must read. It's so fantastic. So a must read is an opinion, whereas bestseller is factual. And we've got Bezad saying, I'm a kind of well-read person. Okay, good. Glad to hear it. Kim Yontan has said, I have read the book named The Midnight Library last month. Okay, so because this is a finished event, okay, we'll just use the past simple. I read the book named The Midnight Library last month. It's a great book. I've read it myself. It is fantastic. Evgeny, the best book I've ever read is One Day. I liked it a lot. I've read it as well. It is a good read. Very good read. Okay. So Christina saying, the Bible is a must read. Nice example. And Manuel has taken a different angle. For example, Covent Garden is a must see if you go to London. Excellent stuff, Manuel. So loads of good book recommendations coming in, but we can't look at them all. So let's move on to round two. Aha. So here we're looking for the missing word, the missing vocabulary word here. So which of these is not correct? I listened to an interesting last night. So we're looking for a noun here, but usually we think of talk and speak as being verbs, don't we? So what's the correct answer here? A, I listened to an interesting talk. B, I listened to an interesting speak. Or C, I listened to an interesting speech. Which of these is not correct? One more time, 3 seconds. 3, 2, 1. And the correct answer is speak. Let's have a look. We saw a nice answer here, if I can find it. Huda Huda says, be is not used as a noun. Yes, exactly that. So speech is a noun. Talk can be used as a noun. In this example, talk means noun. And this is a noun that means a formal discussion or lecture. So it's a talk. So what is it? I've lost my train of thought here. So we're looking for, I listened to an interesting talk last night. Makes sense. I listened to an interesting speech. We can use both of these. We do not use speak as a noun. So a talk is a lecture or an address where somebody gives talks to a room full of people. They give a speech. They educate the people in the room on a certain topic. So you might have heard of the famous TED Talks, where some of the world's greatest minds speak about important issues. The verb we use with talk is give a talk or listen to a talk. A speech is similar, and it means a formal talk where one person gives a talks to a group of people. The difference between a talk and a speech is that a talk usually aims to educate the audience, but a speech can be used for a variety of reasons. So we give speeches at a wedding, we give a speech at a funeral or at graduation, and they can be used to entertain or inform or amuse or advise. Speak is a verb and cannot be used here as a noun. So let's have a look. Any questions about that from you? Any questions? So this blank needs a noun exactly, and speak is not a noun. Good. Yes, similar from Aliasa. Any more questions? Okay. TED Talks, let's change it. So Julia, nice sentence. Let's just say, TED Talks are a riveting way to learn English. Okay. Another noun phrase, small talk. Good. Let's have a look. And we've got an example. Yeah, for example, small talk about the weather, for example. Okay, good. Any other questions? No more questions. So on we go. Question number three, we got phrasal verbs. So which of these phrasal verbs means to talk louder? Speak, we can't hear you at the back. Speak, is it speak up, speak out, speak volumes, or speak your mind? To speak, we can't hear you at the back. So which of these means to talk louder? Speak, And lots of you said A and B. Speak up and speak out were the popular answers, but are they the correct answers? Let's find out. 3, 2, 1. Speak up is the correct answer. So when we ask someone to speak up, we ask them to talk louder, to speak in a louder volume. It is an imperative. We tell or instruct people what to do. Speak up. We can't hear you. Okay, so talk louder. Talk in a louder voice. Now, we can use speak up, speak out, and speak your mind in a similar way. And that means to say something publicly and honestly. To criticize something, to criticize something in public. So we use it when we think something is unjust or wrong. I had to speak out against the sexist policies at my workplace, you might say. Or Marco spoke out against his boss's behavior. And we could say, Rita always speaks her mind. So this is when you publicly and vocally say something to criticize. You speak up, speak out, or speak your mind. But all of them are similar, but we only use speak up. Talk louder can only be speak up. How about speak volumes? Does anybody know? What does speak volumes mean? This is when something gives us a lot of information without using words. So his new smart suit spoke volumes. He was ready for business. So just without saying anything, you can look at somebody and go, okay, I can hear the message they're trying to send. Or we could say, Martha said nothing when she opened her present, but her face spoke volumes. She didn't say I'm happy, but her eyes and her smile really let you know that she's really super happy. Okay, so we got speak out. What is the meaning of speak out? So to speak out is to talk publicly about an injustice, something that you think is wrong or incorrect. So maybe you think that one of your colleagues has been speaking a little bit rudely to another colleague. So you speak out, you say, hey, excuse me, I don't think you should talk like that. So you speak out, you say, I think this is wrong. Speak out. Okay, to speak up for yourself is to protect yourself against somebody who's trying to bully you or who is maybe making you feel uncomfortable, but you speak up and you stand up. Similar to stand up, okay? You publicly say, I'm not happy with the situation. Okay. Okay, Tangina's put a nice definition here. Speak up is a phrasal verb meaning to speak more loudly. Okay. Speak more clearly means to stop mumbling. So if I'm going to talk like this, you say, speak more clearly. Speak up means to speak more loudly. Yes, Tressa. So speak volumes means something conveys a great deal of information without using words. Okay. My teacher usually asks my friend to speak up. Good. Teachers are always doing this. I've been a teacher myself for a long time. I'm always asking the students to speak up at the back, please. So yes, Penny Lynn asks, is body language or facial expressions equal speak volume? So yes, we often use body language or facial expressions to speak volumes. It could be the way you stand or what you are wearing or what you are doing. It can also be an action. But when you do something and people can get a lot of information from it, but you haven't said anything, that is when we use speak volumes. Aha. So a photo can speak volumes. Lovely, lovely example. Okay. So Sana says, don't speak up in front of your parents. I suppose it depends on your parents and your relationship with them. Is it the same meaning of raise your voice? Yes. Okay. Raise your voice is to speak a bit more loudly. We often use raise your voice when we are angry, but speak up just means speak loudly. It's very neutral, whereas raise your voice has got a negative connotation where it might mean you spoke loudly because you were angry. Okay. And speak down is the opposite. Speak quiet. So instead of saying speak down, you say quieten down. Become more quiet. Quieten down. Whew. Good questions, everybody. We got one last example. Artists use their platforms to speak out against racism. Faridun, lovely example sentence. Thank you very much. Okay, round four. It's a hot day here today. Whew. So we're looking at question tags. Which of these question tags works best? The test wasn't so bad. The test wasn't so bad, were it? The test wasn't so bad, was it? The test wasn't so bad, wasn't it? Or the best, the test wasn't so bad, didn't it? So question tags, as I mentioned earlier, something that is really important for spoken English, everyday English, for conversational English. And students often get it wrong, but there's quite a simple rule. And when it clicks, You go, aha, and it becomes very, very easy. So we got lots of B's coming in on the second time. The first time there's a bit more variety, but I think now you're going with the crowd. And well done, because yes, that is the correct answer. Let's take a look. So question tags, they work by turning a statement into a question by adding a little tag, a little short tag at the end, which usually the person you ask can respond to in a yes or no manner. So you're here for the interview today, aren't you? Very relaxed, much more informal than, are you here for the interview? So it's a lot, it's a way of making informal, friendly speech, okay? Or informal, everyday speech. If the statement is positive, the tag is negative. We are meeting this afternoon, aren't we? If the statement is negative, the tag is positive. The job situation isn't getting any better, is it? Okay, so statement positive, tag negative. Statement negative, tag positive. The statement and the question tag must match. So the same pronoun and the same verbs must be present. So Barbara hasn't eaten lunch today. Has she? You don't own a computer, do you? And you are living in Prague, aren't you? So the noun or the pronoun and the verb must match. Okay, let's take a look. Theater four. Yilin, flattery gets you everywhere. Dylan explains the vocabulary well, doesn't he? Okay, so good. Thank you very much. Very good. Okay, so Marcello, the negative's already at the beginning. So we got a negative statement. So we need a positive question tag. Great. Okay. You are an English teacher, aren't you? Evgeny, you don't live in Liverpool anymore, do you? Evgeny, yes, I do, but I commute and I work in London quite a lot. So my main home is in Liverpool, but I work in London quite a lot because that's where the BBC is based. Good example question. Can we use it in writing? In general, no. This is for spoken English. Okay, so you can use it in text messages to your friends, but we don't use it in formal writing. Okay, good job, everybody. And now round number five is where we welcome back our special guest, which is Jia Ying. Welcome back.
Hiya.
Hi, good to have you back. So you had a lovely question for us. Could you just repeat the question one more time for anybody who's just joined us?
Sure. The question was, which one of these four words doesn't rhyme with the rest? So which one is the odd one out?
Okay, so which one does not rhyme, doesn't sound the same, has a slightly different pronunciation, correct?
Yes.
I think I've actually got a slide here. Let me get it up.
Okay.
There you are, nice and clear for everybody here. Okay, so get your answers coming in. So, cuff muscle, is that correct, Jia Ying? Is that what cuff is?
That's not the answer, unfortunately.
Okay, it's not the answer. So it's not D. Could you tell us what is the correct answer, please?
Sure, the correct answer is B, cough.
Okay. And could you read all four of these words for us?
Of course. A is pronounced tough. Tough. And B is cough. So that sounds different. C is rough. Rough. And D is pronounced cuff.
Okay, cuff. So A, C, and D all rhyme and sound similar, whereas cough has got a different pronunciation.
Exactly. Although A, B, and C have the same letter combinations at the end. So that was the tricky part.
It is. O-U-G-H is one of those tricky aspects of English. We have done a very good video on this. We had Thomas, made a nice little video I was going to share explaining all the rules about OUGH. There's not many rules, but there's lots of guidelines and tips on how to improve your pronunciation of OUGH. And I've just put that in the chat for everybody. So check it out after the quiz. Now, Jiaying, you gave us a little tip earlier about how to improve your pronunciation, but do you have any other tips that you could give us?
Yeah, another thing I always do is I would rewatch a movie or a TV show and imitate the ways characters say their lines. So I'd watch it first with bilingual subtitles when I can for the story. Then I would watch it again with no subtitles at all or with only the English to focus on the language in the movie. So sometimes I would use the English subtitles as a reference and repeat the lines of in my favorite scenes, or I just do that without any subtitles on, so I can practice both my listening and my pronunciation.
And do you think it's just enough to listen to the to a movie or TV show, or should it be like active focus listening?
What I always do is just watch it the first time because you want to get the full experience. You want to know what's going on.
To enjoy it.
Yeah. I would probably, if you don't have time to rewatch the whole thing, maybe pick a few scenes where you think there's good language that you can learn from, and then put on only the English subtitles and or no subtitles at all.
Okay. Cool. So a nice, excellent tip. I got a little question from the audience for you. Could you repeat the sound of this word, please?
Of course. C-O-U-G-H is pronounced cough. Cough.
Okay. So the listeners can start using your tips already and repeat after you. So listen.
Great.
And then repeat. So one more time, Jiaying, so they can put theory into practice.
Yes. Cough. Cough.
Okay.
Cough.
Good. And we've got Latanya. Where are you from?
I am from China, but I'm right now I'm based in London.
Okay, cool. And let me see if there's any other questions. So the pronunciation of cuff and the meaning of cuff, is it like handcuff?
I think mostly. Yes, yeah. Handcuff. Cuff.
Yeah, so the cuff is this part of your shirt here, the cuff part. Or we can also use it in handcuff, which is when you go to jail and your hands are tied together. Okay, cool. And just in case anybody's new, Jiaying, aren't you a native English speaker?
I'm very flattered that you say that, but I'm actually not a native English speaker. My native language is Chinese.
So, you know, like, it's great to have you here as someone who's learned the English language themselves, and you've studied pronunciation very hard. Any other tips while we're here?
So when you learn, when say you're listening to an English podcast or watching a movie in English, and you're trying to repeat some of the key words or examples to practice your pronunciation, try to pay attention to only one aspect of pronunciation that you want to work on. Say, you know, you want to focus on stress or connected speech, then be more conscious about that aspect when you're listening to something. So what this has done for me is it's allowed me to improve one thing at a time rather than getting really frustrated because there are just so many things to work on.
Yes. So English is a long journey. We've got to take it step by step. And by being focused on one aspect, we can improve at that. And then, you know, take one thing at a time rather than trying to learn everything in one big go.
Yeah, exactly what you said.
Okay. Jiaying, lots of people saying hello to you and they're very happy for your top tips. Thank you for joining us. And it's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks, Jiaying. See you, everyone. Bye.
Okay, thank you, Jiaying. And Jiaying forgot one top tip, which is subscribe to BBC Learning English. Check out our Facebook page, check out our Twitter, Instagram, subscribe on YouTube, or check out our website where we've got loads of pronunciation practice. Jiaying, thank you so much. Okay, then. Where were we? Question 6. Okay. Question six was a vocabulary question, or a slang question. So Mika was, well, that his team had won. So we're looking for the slang word, the informal British English word that means happy, pleased. Okay, your team, Mika's team has won. He was well, and well here means very. He was well chuffed. Okay, so these are three very common British English words. Chuffed means happy, pleased. You're in a good mood. Yes, okay. So let's think of some example sentences for you. So let's do, it's Friday afternoon, work finishing soon. I am chuffed that the week is finishing. Okay, good. I am chuffed that so many of you have given so many good answers today. Okay. I will be chuffed if you can give me some example sentences with chuffed. Gutted means to be disappointed. I can't meet up this weekend. Ah, I'm gutted. Oh, my team lost. I'm gutted. I had an F in the test. I am gutted. Sad, disappointed. Knackered has two meanings in slang. The most common one is very, very, very tired. Oh, what a long week. I am knackered. Or it can mean something is broken. So I dropped my phone and now it's knackered. It doesn't work anymore. So three very common British English terms. If you are looking at traveling or moving or coming to the UK or watching British TV shows, these three words really, really commonly used. Abdul is chuffed because his son got an excellent grade in his exams. A round of applause for Abdul's son. Well done. Okay. Gauha says, he was really chuffed about it when we put him on the plane. A holiday. It's always a good mood. Always feeling good. Chuffed. Yes, we am. I'm chuffed to be here. I'm chuffed that you came. Shima was chuffed because of your son's success. Round of applause. Let's have a look. Okay, so unfortunately, Jiaying is gone. This question has come in. And it's going back a little bit, but when we work on pronunciation, can we listen to both American and British podcasts, or is it better to listen to one type? So it depends on what your goal is. If you would like to speak with a British accent, then focus on British English. If you'd like to learn American English, focus on American podcasts. But if you just want to have better pronunciation, clear pronunciation, you can use both. Okay, no problem to use both, because then you can understand and, you know, communicate well with people from around the globe. Okay, let's have a look. Erica, I am chuffed to hear you. Okay, what is the past tense of chuffed? Good question. We say I was chuffed. So chuffed is an adjective. It doesn't change tenses. I was chuffed. I am chuffed. I will be chuffed. Chuffed means I'm very pleased. I'm dead chuffed to have won. And in British English, we can use well or dead to mean very. I'm well chuffed. I'm well gutted. I'm dead chuffed. I'm dead gutted. Well and dead can mean very. Whew. Good. Everybody on top form. Good to have you here again today. I'm chuffed to see you all. Ah, now this, I think, was a tricky question. So when I make the quiz, I send it to Rob. To Rob, is this too easy, too difficult? What do you think? Can you double check it for me? And he said, ooh, I think question number 7 is going to be difficult. But I said, I trust my audience. I think they can get this. I think they will benefit from learning these words and keeping it. So what do you think? Can you put these words in order of volume? Then a little bit louder, then a little bit louder, and then very loud. So which is quietest and which goes up in volume? Okay. Three, two, one. I'll give you a bit more time while we're waiting for more answers. Get that like button, hit, or even better, hit that love button. If you're on YouTube, please subscribe. Okay, put these words in order of volume, and here we go. Whisper, declare, call out, bellow. Okay, so whisper is when we talk very quietly. We don't want people to hear, so we talk like this. Declare is to say something in a serious way. So it's similar volume to said, but a bit serious. Okay, we're talking about something quite formal. Call out is to shout or call quite loud. Hello, is anybody here? Or, hey, Steve, come here. Is to call out quite loud, but not crazy loud. Bellow is to shout as loud as you can. It's a deep, loud roar, and we use it mostly when we are angry or when we are in pain. So Paolo bellowed when he broke his leg. Ah! Okay. Or when somebody's really angry, don't you ever do that again. He bellowed. So we got whisper, declare, call out, bellow. So those are four different ways to say. okay, four different ways to say said. And they're useful to have, especially if you do any writing, because, you know, even native speakers, when I see my teenage students writing, they say said, he said, he said, he said, she said, he said, she said, he said, she said. Okay, but it's nice to have a bit of variety. Bellow is the same sound as a cow can make. So yes, a cow can bellow, and many animals, if they make a loud, deep sound, we use bellow. Okay, I can't bear bellowing. Same here, Huda. If people bellow, gosh, no need. Okay. All right, so let's have a look. Elin said, the question was hard, but I will indeed let Rob know that you got it right. And I had loads of good answers coming in. And I think it's valuable to learn these words, even if you didn't get it right. So don't worry if you got that one wrong. We learned something. And that is the important thing. Okay, so yell, scream, bellow, pretty similar. It's shouting as loud as you can. Okay, so one sentence using bellow. So Stephen bellowed when he fell and twisted his ankle. Ah! Okay, or we can say when Mark had his wallet stolen by a thief, he bellowed at him, get back here. Okay. Bellow and below. So similar, bellow, below. Bellow, to shout, underneath, below. Our final question of the day. Here we go. And here we looked at contractions. Which of these is not a contraction we use in spoken English? So a contraction is when we take one or two or three words and we shorten them down to make them shorter and easier to say. We wouldn't write any of these in formal English. Don't put it in your IELTS test, please. Okay, but we would use it in text messages and social media very frequently, and it's useful to see them spelled out so that when you hear them, you go, ah, I know what they're saying. So which of these is not a contraction in spoken English? A, dunno. B, y'all. C, dear. D, gotta. E, pitta. or F, lemme. So these are, five of them are contractions and one of them is not. Okay. One, I'll give you a little clue. One of them is a delicious bread. So what do you think it is? A, dunno. B, y'all. C, dear. D, gutter. E, pitta. Or F, lemmy. Let's take a look. The correct answer is E, pitta. Pitta is not, pitta is not a contraction. Pitta or pita, you hear both pronunciations, is a type of bread that's common in the Mediterranean and in the Middle East. We eat it a lot in the UK. It's a round flat bread, which we can use to dip into hummus or salsa or other dips. Or it can be opened up and stuffed with other foods like kebab meat, for example. And I've got a little photo for you because it's easier to see sometimes than it is to explain. So we got pitta opened up to be stuffed with meat, or pitta to be used as a dip or just as a bread. Whew. So I'm going to explain these five words. And I'm then going to look at Faradun, who's also giving me some nice examples. Dunno is don't know. I don't know. Don't know. I don't know. Y'all is common in American English. We don't say it much in British English. It's especially used in the south of the United States. And it means similar to you all or everybody here. So if there's a group of your friends and you say, do y'all want to come back to my house? Do y'all, do you all, does everybody want to come back to my house? So y'all is everybody here. Dear, it's kind of changes into a dear, do you? Do you want a drink? Dear. Do you want a drink? Do you want a drink? Dear. And it's, we use it so commonly, we put it together. Dear, like a dear sound. Dear. Okay. Gotta. Got to. Have to. We gotta finish soon. We don't say we've got to finish soon. We commonly say we gotta finish soon. And the last one is lemme, which is let me. Okay, we had a nice example from Faradun. If I can find it, it's gone up here. So Faradun has made some examples. A, I don't know. I don't know. Y'all will go there. Okay. Dear, do you like that? Do you like that? Do you like that? Dear. So it can be dear or dear. Do you like that? Do you like that? D, gotta, I gotta do that. And let me take a look. Okay. Where's my mom? I don't know. Okay, let's take a look. Lots of comments about how much you like pita bread. Me too, it's a delicious bread. So yeah, definitely. How often do British use these? So we use dunno, dear, gotta, lemme all the time. Do you know? Okay, so do you know, if we are speaking to a friend, we use it all the time. We use it in texts sometimes as well, but these contractions in spoken English very, very, very commonly. Okay, and well done. I see lots of 8 out of 8s. Okay. Let's have a look. Do we use these words in writing? Less commonly. So in writing, we use them not so much, but we might, you know, you definitely will see it on the internet, social media, and text messages, 100%. But more commonly, spoken English. Okay, and it's just, it's useful to see them written down, because then you can imagine what it's like when people say it. So if my friends ask me, are you going out tonight? And I'm not sure. I don't say, I don't know. I say, I don't know. So seeing the spelling can really help you Imagine how it is pronounced in real life, everyday English. The quiz is nearly finished. I've got to go. The quiz is nearly finished. I gotta go. So the spelling shows how we really pronounce it. Okay. Do we just have five contractions in British English? Absolutely not. We've got loads and loads of them. And, you know, there's the ones that we use all the time. So I am, I'm, he is, he's, should have, should have. There are loads and loads of them. We use contractions all the time. Yes, absolutely. Okay. Every single day that I speak English, I use contractions. Whew. All right then, everybody. So thank you so much for joining me yet again. As I mentioned at the start, we are making some changes to the quiz. So if you've got any thoughts on what you would like or what you'd like us to do or focus on or what you enjoy about the quiz, what you'd like more of, or what you'd like less of, let us know. Put us in the comment section, you know, on YouTube or Facebook, because it stays up. And then we can look back and we'll try and put that into the quiz if we can. If you enjoyed today, please hit that like button. Thank you so much. See you again very, very soon. Bye, everybody.